Good evening. I'm David Oxtoby, President of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and it's my pleasure to welcome you and to call to the order the 2085th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Tonight's program is our annual Morton L. Mandel Distinguished Lecture, named in honor of one of the most generous supporters of the Academy and its work. As many of you may know, Mort passed away earlier this month at the age of 98. We here at the Academy are greatly indebted to him. In addition to sponsoring this annual lecture, he has helped us to establish our membership engagement program, further the impact of our studies, provide greater outreach to members across the country and around the world, and address issues with our technology and infrastructure. In 2016, we honored Mort with the Academy's Scholar Patriot Award. I share with you some words from his citation. "You have taught us to dream and to believe dreams can be realized. We are better off because of you." One of the features of the Mandel Lecture is that we live stream the program to remote locations around the country where groups are gathered to have their own discussions on tonight's talk. So while I am pleased to welcome those of you in our auditorium this evening, Academy fellows, neighbors, guests from higher education institutions in the greater Cambridge-Boston area, I'm also pleased to greet those joining us remotely from our satellite discussions across the country at the Association of American Universities in Washington, D.C., the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and Columbia Teachers College. I'd like to offer a special thank you to our facilitators for those satellite discussions: Mary Sue Coleman, Emily Miller, and Tobin Smith in Washington, Harry Brighaus in Madison, and Thomas Bailey and Clive Belfield in New York. Tonight's program continues the conversation contained within the pages of the just-released fall 2019 edition of our journal, Daedalus, entitled "Improving Teaching, Strengthening the College Learning Experience." This volume builds off the work of our Commission on the Future of Undergraduate Education. In its final report, among other recommendations, the Commission called for greater understanding about how students learn, about how to develop and support effective teaching at the college level, and about how to ensure that we are truly educating students, not just providing them with credentials. We're thrilled to have with us tonight the co-editors of that fall 2019 issue of Daedalus, Sandy Baum and Michael McPherson. Dr. Baum is a non-resident fellow at the Center on Education Data and Policy at the Urban Institute. She is also Professor Emerita of Economics at Skidmore College. An expert on higher education finance, she speaks and writes extensively about issues related to college access, college pricing, student aid policy, student debt, and affordability. Michael S. McPherson is the President Emeritus of the Spencer Foundation and a non-resident fellow in the Center on Education Data and Policy at the Urban Institute, an economist whose expertise focuses on the interplay between education and economics. Dr. McPherson seeks in his work to improve education by finding ways to align the search for new knowledge with the practical challenges of effecting positive change. He also served as president of McAllister College from 1997 to 2003. Tonight, our speakers will look at the issues of how students learn, how to improve teaching at the college level, and how to ensure that students are truly getting educated. Their discussion will be informed by their essay in Daedalus, "The Human Factor: The Promise and Limits of Online Education," which examines these questions through the lens of advances in educational technology. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Baum and Dr. McPherson.
Well, thank you very much, and thanks to you all for being here, and to our colleagues around the country. We look forward to hearing all about your discussions later this evening. And I just want to point out that the game doesn't start until after 8 o'clock Eastern time. So we're going to focus in our remarks here on the general problem of teaching and learning in American higher education. Our interest in this problem grows directly out of the work of this commission, which I co-chaired and of which Sandy was a member. a basic insight that we discovered in the work on the commission was that the nature of the problem of higher education in the U.S. for undergraduate students as a whole has really changed in the last 20 or 30 years. The traditional access problem, although it's not completely solved, is no longer the most prominent difficulty. We were surprised to see that by the time people are 30 years old, 90% of high school graduates have at least attempted college. But about half of those students began at a community college. And for those students, only about 38% have achieved any kind of credential after 6 years for programs that are generally intended to run for 2 years. In baccalaureate institutions, four-year colleges, it's still true that about a third of the students who begin there don't have any kind of credential after 6 years. So the problem is much more one of achieving success in college than of having initial access to it. And that's where our energies need to be devoted. The commission understood success as having several elements. Most importantly, a worthwhile college experience. This isn't just about counting BAs, counting AAs, counting certificates. It's about learning. What do people learn in college that's of value to them in their lives and in their careers? It's very hard to have a successful college experience if you don't move on to completion. So completion is an important criterion for success. And it's also important that you come out of that experience of college in decent financial shape. That is, you don't wind up borrowing so much money or straining your capacity so far that you're really struggling for a long time after you complete your college experience. So in the lingo that has developed around these things, the commission was concerned with quality, with completion, and affordability. And we came to see that the quality question was actually more neglected than the other two. The question of what are people really learning in college, how is value being brought to them, we think is insufficiently examined. And I really want to underscore the judgment of these 30 and more very thoughtful people who worked hard on this, that the quality of undergraduate teaching really must rise to meet the nation's needs over the next 25 years. This is a big challenge. We found this message to resonate. Members of the commission have been in all of these places over the last 2 years, and we have found wherever we go that those points about quality really get a lot of nods from the audience. This is not something that in our numerical obsessions we have really paid enough attention to. Too often faculty in our system get little instruction when they're in graduate school about how to teach undergraduates well. Often they are selected for appointment without much regard for their teaching. They receive only limited support to improve their teaching over time, and they get little reliable feedback on how well they're doing as teachers. This is a big challenge for American higher education. And we have to understand that a good education is not simply learning to parrot back the subject matter that was in your textbook. Students need to learn how to engage with the material. Teachers need to learn how to engage students so that they can think productively about whatever material, whatever subject matter they're asked to pay attention to, and so they can put their subject matter knowledge to work in solving problems, in critical thinking, and in understanding. Several of the articles in our volume concentrate on the scholarship of teaching, on systematic study of teaching improvement. Currently, that work is mostly in the natural sciences, and a good part of the explanation for that is the National Science Foundation will support work on improved teaching in the sciences. There's not really a counterpart in other disciplines. In our volume, we have Carl Wyman from Stanford, Sally Hoskins from Boston College and a team from the American Association of Universities led by Mary Sue Coleman. We have found that interest is growing in other fields, notably including history and English and economics, among other fields. So this is one major contribution that we hope our volume makes toward better thinking and better work in this area. Sustained change, sustained improvement, will require support and engagement and money from administrators. But it really, more than that, requires leadership and a sense of mission from the faculty. We all know that these places don't work by command and control from above. The faculty need to embrace this agenda for the future. And I want to end my part of the remarks with a key thought from Carl Wieman, a Nobel laureate who abandoned bench science in order to study how to improve teaching in the sciences. What he discovered is that it's hard to change how you teach. It takes time and effort. But once you have done it, it turns out that teaching well is actually only a little bit harder than teaching badly. And it's much more rewarding. So, Sandy?
Thank you. So in this issue of Daedalus, which I see everybody, you know, carrying around, and maybe you'll open it, you will find a number of articles about teaching, but also a number of articles about the environment in which students learn. And this is something that, you know, we came to think of as incredibly important, that the how you learn obviously has something to do with the skill and the dedication of your teachers, but it also has to do with the other people around you. It has to do with the sense of self that you develop as a student. And so we want to make sure that we focus as well on that. Now, sometimes, I mean, if you think about a residential college campus, it's easy to understand that. If you think about students living in dormitories and hanging around all the time with other students and eating in the dining hall, then you can think about their extracurricular activities and what clubs they're in. Then it becomes sort of obvious that their education is not occurring entirely in the classroom. But actually, this is an important issue about learning on all sorts of campuses. So we also, in this volume and here, want to talk about the issue of the relationships among people in different groups, racial and ethnic groups, socioeconomic groups. We want to talk about the kind of support systems that are in place so that students both can strengthen their academic skills and gain the kind of self-confidence and knowledge that they need in order to accomplish their goals. And another issue is the interaction among students and also among faculty and students and staff and students, that learning takes place in a community. And even if it's not a residential community, even if it's a place where you come to campus just to take your courses, still the interaction with other people is really important. And we'll talk at least here more later about what if you're not physically located together with other people. And of course, the learning is not just about the subject matter. So we need to think about how to teach people science. That's incredibly important. But we also need to teach people, to help people learn about themselves and about becoming complete human beings and about how to become people who are active civic participants and actively engage with each other. So this environment that creates all of those things has to be central at all types of institutions, not just at residential colleges. There is a difference of opinion. There's a lot of research on how much difference it makes if you live on campus. And for a long time, people were saying, you know, we really have to get more students to live on campus because it increases the probability of completion. There are some newer studies that, you know, question that. But whether or not it's really helpful to live on campus, the fact is that most students don't and won't live on campus, right? There are a lot of older students, returning students, students going to public two-year colleges, the way they don't even have dormitories. So living on campus can't be the definition of being part of a college community. And it doesn't mean that you can't have some sort of engagement with the other people around you. You can attend events. You can interact with people outside of the classroom. There need to be spaces where people can interact. There needs to be some sort of effort to get people to engage in this process of learning. And the learning community doesn't have to be a 24/7 learning community that, you know, many people in this room probably at the age of 18 or 19 went off to a residential college, and that's our vision. But that vision can't be the only vision that we have of how you engage the whole person and make sure that they're in an environment where they can learn. In this volume of Daedalus, we have a wonderful paper by Beverly Tatum. Why are all the black students sitting together? Is that the name of it? In the cafeteria? Yeah, so she's written this amazing book about, you know, how it can be that, you know, you can have, for many college students, the college is the most integrated place, the most diverse place that they've ever been. Like, they may have grown up in a neighborhood and gone to a high school where everybody looks like them, and then they come to college and there are lots of different people, but the fact that the population has lots of diversity doesn't mean that people are actually having meaningful interaction with people who are different from themselves. And that's a really important issue, and it's a particularly important issue for people who are the minority on their campuses, right? Because, you know, if you feel out of place and you feel like you can't actually relate to the other people and communicate with them and exchange ideas with them, then that's a serious problem. Also in this issue of Daedalus, Jennifer Morton has a really interesting paper about the challenges facing first-generation students who are sort of leaving a community, a family and a community where they have belonged for their whole lives and moving into a world where in some sense what they're trying to do is move away from their origins. And how do you adapt to that? How do you maintain this positive connection with both of these worlds? And it's a real challenge. And part of that challenge obviously can interfere with how students learn, not just about themselves, but about the subject matter that we hope that they will master while they are students. There was a wonderful article in the Sunday Times Magazine, maybe many of you saw it, by Tony Jack, who wrote a book called The Privileged Poor, where he talks about the differences in the experiences of students from low-income backgrounds who went to fancy high schools and so earlier on got integrated into a different kind of environment versus people who come to college straight from an environment where they have had no contact with the kinds of people that they come into contact with and the expectations that they come into contact with in college. And how do you get all of these people in these different environments to have a sense of belonging? And it's interesting, I think it's very hard for people to understand this. I was talking yesterday, actually, to a friend who, with whom I went to college, who talked about how she came from a background where she didn't know anybody like the people who were in college, and she felt really inadequate, and there was no money, and she couldn't do any of these other things. And she's a highly successful person, and she's very much a part of a different world. Her kids are growing up differently. But she had never thought about the reality that these environments on college campuses are really important to those students. It hadn't occurred to her to translate her experience into the experience of students today who are struggling to be part of a community and develop a sense of self that will allow them to learn well. It's so easy to separate out, you know, the sort of social part of it from how you learn the academics, but you can't separate them out because that's a huge reason why many students struggle academically. So we need to make sure that there are academic supports and that there are social supports and that they meet the needs of all the different kinds of people who are going to college. And it's not that, look, I bristle a little bit at this idea of the students of today, today's students, or the students of the 21st century. Lots of students are 18-year-olds coming from middle and upper middle class families to residential colleges, but many students are also adults. They're single parents. They are people who don't know anybody else who's been to college. We have a whole diversity of students, and we have to meet all of their needs. And it's complicated to be able to do that, but that is something that we have to think about in an integrated way with students, you know, as we develop the learning experience. And students need a lot more guidance about the choices that they make about their educational pathways. Just the idea that, you know, you come here and you're supposed to know what you're doing, obviously for many students, that's not possible. So one of the issues, I think, in thinking about this is that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. We hear more and more conversations these days about, you know, how do we, give people the training that they need, basically, and whether or not people use the word training, to be successful in the workplace. And people are thinking, how do you get the necessary skills? You know, how do you learn how to code? And obviously people need to do that, but they need to do a lot more than that. And so when people talk about sort of tearing apart higher education into pieces, I see this as sort of a pop bead vision of higher education. You could take a course here and a course there and a course there, and if you have all the credits and they add up, you have a college degree. But if you think about it that way, you're totally missing what it means to have an education. And first of all, many students who don't have the kinds of supports I've been talking about will never get through all those courses and they won't add up to the college degree. But even if they do, if that's the way we define it, then we're missing a lot of what it means to create environments where students can actually learn, and we need to make sure that we focus on all of the students there. We need to focus on the first generation students. We need to focus again on the students who are different from most of the students on their campuses. And we also need to focus on the other students and not assume that if they're not in the minority on their campus, that they don't face any of these problems. It turns out that how people relate to each other is really important, is an incredibly important part of the learning process. And so as we focus on what does it mean to teach and learn, we want to make sure that people focus both on the teaching and the pedagogy and developing that skill and on creating environments in which students can learn well. So one of the papers in this issue of Daedalus is our paper called The Human Factor, The Promise and Limits of Online Education. And actually what we wrote about in that paper is very much related to what we've just been talking about. So the promise of online education is great. People have really been thinking that putting things online is going to solve a lot of our problems. One, it should create access for people who have geographical constraints and time constraints, and therefore they can't really get to class in the right time and the right place. So if they can study online, that's going to increase access. Second, it should reduce costs, right? You don't have to have these fancy classrooms. You don't have to have everybody in the same place at the same time. And one professor can stand up here and lecture, and there can be people all over the country listening to this professor, and there's no marginal cost to having extra people in the room, and this will be great. It'll be cheap. We'll give access to everybody. Turns out the reality is much more complicated than that. So using technology can absolutely enhance the learning experience. There's no question about that. However, to use technology well and to use it creatively is not cheap. If you just, you know, have a video of a person standing up giving a lecture, that's pretty cheap to put online and people can watch it, but that's not enhancing the learning experience. So there's a lot of evidence that hybrid courses that combine face-to-face and technology do really well. But there is accumulating evidence that purely online coursework is problematic. And it's problematic particularly for the students about whom we're most concerned about creating access and about how costs might prevent them from benefiting from higher education, because the less prepared students, those who have low GPAs, those who don't have a lot of experience with technology, are least likely to succeed in these courses. And actually, contrary to our optimistic expectations, fully online learning can actually increase the socioeconomic gaps in educational attainment. This is a real problem. Online learning is growing rapidly. About 40% of undergraduate students now take at least one course fully online, and about 11% of undergraduates are in programs that are fully online. I mean, you can be in a program where you never set foot in a physical place where you meet any of the other students or any of the faculty in your program. A disproportionate amount of the fully online work is in the for-profit sector. But there also are a number of public and private nonprofit institutions that have just enrolled tens of thousands of students in fully online programs, and they're getting a lot of attention for that. And it's really, really important that we look at the quality of the learning that is going on in those programs. A lot of experimental studies have been done where they, you know, compare students who learn in a face-to-face environment, in a hybrid environment, in a fully online environment. And what most of these studies show, the well-structured experimental studies show, is that students are more likely to drop out from the fully online courses and less likely to pass those courses than they are traditional courses. The students who struggle the most, again, are those who are least well prepared. If the people in this room decide they want to take an online course, a fully online course, you know, if you've already got a college degree, if you know how to study, if you've got self-discipline, if you're highly motivated, you probably do fine. But if you don't have all of those things, you know, then it's going to be really challenging for you if you're at home, like the way the TV commercials are, at home in your pajamas doing this, whenever you have a free moment, it's going to be much, much harder for you. And so, again, this is a huge problem, because if the completion, the gap in completion rates and success rates is greater across these groups in fully online courses than in other courses, then we're going to just have growing gaps as we start telling people, oh, you can do this for less, you can do this more conveniently. Why does this happen? I mean, the first thing is that, you know, it's not that the answer is technology is a terrible thing. Technology, again, can be very important to enhancing the learning experience, but there's a lot of variation, and there obviously is a lot of variation in standard classrooms and a lot of variation in online learning, and, you know, I've had a number of people say to me, but I taught an online course and it was great, and I'm sure that's true. There are great online courses, and there are obviously, most of us have experienced terrible brick and mortar or classroom courses. And if what it is a lecture to 1,000 people and all you're doing is sitting there in the back room and not listening, that's not great either. There's lots of variation. But the fact is that human interaction is very important. Interaction among students, interaction between faculty members and students. There have even been experiments where if you watch the lecture in a room or you watch the lecture by yourself at home, people do better if they're watching it with other people. And the fact is, everybody's sitting here right now in this room, right? And there's some reason that we still gather. And so we really need to understand better these human interactions and understand that learning is really a social process. Mike?
So I want to take just a minute or two to step back from these findings that are reported in our paper, as Sandy has just described. I think they're important findings, and we can put them in context. You know, this internet stuff is not the first time we've actually tried to do education without personal interaction. Going back to the 1850s, the University of London offered correspondence programs for people who were very far distant from London, you know, working elsewhere in the British Empire, either English people who were working elsewhere or people who lived in those countries. And it provided some of the opportunities for education that would otherwise be provided in London. Nobody thought that this was better than what you could get by being in London, but it was a lot more practical. And in fact, one of the greatest examples is that Nelson Mandela and his imprisoned colleagues on Robben Island got degrees from the University of London Extension Program. So that was a clear response to the absence of the opportunity to get the sort of the real thing. Surprised me to learn that educational radio was a real fad in the 1920s. This thing had been developed that could broadcast classes. If you ever want to know why there are so many stations, radio stations, whose initials correspond to universities, it's because they started with the aim of broadcasting courses. People thought you could simulate what it was like to be in a discussion by listening to a radio drama. Turns out that public radio is very important, very valuable, but not because people take courses in it. And of course, educational television, I mean, when I was a kid, I remember Sunrise Semester, and I actually took a course in how to use a slide rule, talk about obsolescence. But everybody came to understand that these are things you do as a compromise with a difficult situation where a problem needs to be solved. So in part, that's what these efforts, including the internet, are, a compromise with locational difficulties. But it also is in part an underlying conception of how education works. It's a conception that learning happens within individual brains, and that you can do just as good a job of learning sitting in your pajamas in front of a computer as you can interacting with people in a room. In that conception of things, social interaction is incidental. You know, it's easier to teach 10 people at once than to teach one, so you crowd people together in rooms, and that's just happenstance. But in fact, I think we've come to understand much better, partly by looking at what goes on with the internet, that learning is valuable, social interaction is valuable both as a support to learning, that is, to see other people struggle with the material, is a real encouragement to know that you can struggle as well. If you're by yourself, you can fantasize that everybody else gets this and I'm just a loser who doesn't get it. But we're all losers, and so we spend our time together learning that. More than that, an awful lot of what's important in education, the content of what you're learning, is actually learning how to communicate, learning how to express yourself, how to understand other people, how to engage in problem solving collectively, whether at work or in the community, and how to work as part of a team. This kind of learning starts with kindergarten, and it never stops as long as you are educating yourself with other people. So we don't mean to say that technology can't be valuable. And in fact, I think there's lots of evidence that it can be quite valuable. But less as a replacement for social interaction, and more as a complement or an aid to successful interaction. Hybrid courses that combine some traditional methods of instruction with video stuff, flipped classrooms that reverse the role of discussion and lecturing by putting the lectures on video, other kinds of technologies. This stuff really seems to be valuable. The only problem with it is it's not spectacularly cheap. And unfortunately, as in many things in life, cheap and good don't always go together. So I think at this point, we're done with all of our spiels. And I think we're going to adjourn to these chairs and hear your talks.